Thank you. Good morning, or rather good evening, or good afternoon. Here we are. It's afternoon, 4 o'clock on Wednesday, December the 8th. As this is a special meeting of council regarding the Delay Bay Landing Development Corporation shareholders meeting, and I'll call this meeting to order and ask if there are any conflicts of interest. Seeing none, I'm just going to read the land acknowledgement for this meeting. The Town of Midland recognizes that it is located on land which is the traditional and treaty territory of the Anishinaabeg people, now known as the Chippewa Tri-Council, comprised of Bosley First Nation, Rama First Nation, and the Georgina Island First Nation. This territory is within the pre-Confederation Treaty 5 and Treaty 16 and included within the Williams Treaties of 1923. The Town of Midland recognizes that it is located on land which is the traditional territory of the Huron-Wendat and the historic homelands of the Métis, and that our town is home to a large and diverse community of Indigenous peoples. With that, I have a motion moved by Councillor Olszewski, seconded by Deputy Mayor Ross, who's joined us, that the contents of the Special Meeting of Council, Middle Bay Landing Development Corporation Annual General Meeting agenda for December 8th, 2021, be approved. Comments or questions around the agenda? Seeing none, all in favor? Thank you, and that carries. Welcome, Councillor Prost. Sorry, I just have to make an adjustment here. I have a motion. We'll move right to presentations, and I have the chair of the Middle Bay Landing Development Corporation, Mr. Bill Kernahan, who will be presenting to council. Mr. Kernahan.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and councilors. It's a pleasure to be here with you today, and I'm going to ask that we start the presentation. If we can pop it up. There we go. So as the mayor said, this is the annual general meeting of Midland Bay Landing Development Corporation with the shareholder for this year. Next slide, please. So the agenda for today and our report to you today consists of four different things: our achievements in 2021, financial report to November the 30th, our work plan for 22, and a draft budget for 22. Next slide. So let's wind the clock back and look at what we've been doing in 2021. We obtained updates from the town on the approval process for the environment from the ministry. And the goal was to obtain a record of site condition after a number of comments from the ministry. Resubmissions were made, and we got a letter, or the town got a letter from the ministry on October the 29th, saying that they were prepared to issue a record of site condition. However, the town needed to respond to the various conditions. Once the town has responded, it is posted on a public registry. After that, there's a certificate of property use that is granted, and then the record of site condition is granted. So that process, being a public process, does take some time. There's a 30-day period in there to do that. So hopefully in January, we will actually get the final document. But the good thing is the 3 years of going through this is finally ended, and we now know what the extent of the environmental issues are for the site. We engaged a brand trade, as you know, to undertake a feasibility study for the possibility of getting designated as UNESCO Global Geopark. That study was endorsed by council unanimously in September of 21. Why is this important? It's really important to the town of Midland, the whole of North Simcoe, and an additional beneficiary, in fact, is the Midland Bay Landing development itself. So this is a great opportunity for this whole area to be designated and will have significant financial benefits over time. And we will generate some of that benefit too. We undertook some confidential market soundings with potential developers to determine what their interest was in the property and get some feedback from them to inform the type of procurement process for selecting developers. And as you know, it's on the agenda. At our request, we asked the town if they would undertake a zoning bylaw amendment to remove the former industrial designations on the property to a new zone called deferred development, which would mean that in essence, we will work out with the developer the actual zoning on the site. And that is before you tonight. So that has been moving along, all of which is a benefit to developers to understand where in the process is this and how quickly can they get going. Next slide, please. So the other major thing that we've been doing, we relocated the interim use area that we originally talked about being further to the west and moved it over to the former coal dock, which you've all seen by now. So it was much more visible to the public and accessible to the public. We engaged with a design team to work on the promenade itself. And in so doing, we actually widened the promenade itself to 7 meters. It was considerably narrower in the master plan. So this was far more pedestrian friendly and gave that access to the waterfront, direct access to the water's edge that the public had told the town through all of the different public meetings. So how did we do that? Well, in the master plan, which is really a framework, there's a lot of planting areas. So we widened the public space and reduced the amount of planting space. And then there still is additional roadways and sidewalks that get to the front face of the buildings. But we did that on purpose because all of the research that we'd done into these front waterfront promenades said, this is public space, or a place that you can enjoy and stop and enjoy, look out on the bay. So that's what we did. We increased the width of that. We awarded a contract to a Penetang contractor, Macon Construction, to build it, and we administered the contract. It is now finished. And we opened the promenade, as you know, on October the 23rd, and it was well accepted across various media outlets, and there's been good public use of it ever since. So that was a big step in showing the public what the promenade can look like in the future. So in the future, this promenade is not just 1,100 meters of this. There will be different ways that the public can interface in the promenade or water's edge. You can interface with the water's edge. It could be areas where it can taper down to the water so that you could literally touch the water. It will not be 1,100 meters like that. Some of it will be like that, but there will be other means to engage with the water as you move more or less another 1,000 meters between the promenade as it stands now to town. So that's still to come. That's part of the development that will take place. The next thing we did was to put out an RFP to engage a real estate advisory consultant to conduct a request for pre-qualifications and then an RFP process to select a developer or developers in 2022. So that was a large undertaking to write the RFP, solicit them. We've now evaluated them, and we'll talk a little bit more about that. The other thing, really important thing to note is that over the past years, we operated 150,000 under our approved 2020 budget, 138,000 under in 2019, and we're forecasting to be about 175,000 under in 2021. Why are we so far under? We're so far under because there is a working group that is doing a huge amount of work at zero cost to the town. In lieu of hiring an executive director, which has been budgeted for these three folks, including myself, are donating our time to the corporation and a benefit to the town to get all of this work done. Everything we said we would do in 21, we did. And we did it at a much lower cost because of how we're doing it. Next step. Next slide, please. So now we look at how are we doing in the budget, which I've already referred to. So to date, the end of November, we've spent $89,000. So we've got 1 month to go. Right now, it looks like, according to this, at the end of November, there's about $187,000 under budget. There are still some other expenses that will come along. So we're forecasting about $175,000 under budget. So it seems that there's a question of honorariums. So the honorariums are part of the compensation that is under the shareholders agreement. And the board members are entitled to honorariums and meeting expenses. However, if a board member wishes to waive their compensation, the shareholders agreement still says that that money should be returned to the corporation and possibly used for other purposes. So we have board members that are not receiving compensation, but that money still remains in the budget and we could possibly use it for other purposes. I thought it was useful to clarify that. All of the rest, if you notice under the consulting fees, we're not too bad on that. The reason is that we didn't undertake some of the consulting, but we're actually going to be doing it and we're proposing to do it next year. That's why we're under. Most of it I've already explained of why, because we're contributing a huge amount of time rather than having charges directly to the town and to the Middle Bank Corporation. Next slide. So what are we going to do next year? So we've just completed the selection of a consultant, as I said, to help us with a two-stage process. The first stage is to put out a public request, fully advertised and marketed hard, so that we get as much market attention as we can and solicitations from many different developers to develop a short list out of a longer list of those that are pre-qualified through a pre-qualification process that will set out the evaluation criteria for the proponents that wish to be considered for doing this development. The key thing is, are they going to have sufficient financial resources to carry on with this development? After that shortlist is done, we're planning to do that in the first quarter, perhaps as soon as the end of February, maybe before the end of the first quarter. So with that, those pre-qualified developers would then go to stage two. And stage two would be a request for proposals from the pre-qualified folks. In that request for proposals, we're not going to be asking them to design the project because they'll be required to substantially follow the master plan. But we'll be looking for proposals from the developers that will include financial considerations. And then in that, there will be it's intended that we enter into a draft letter of intent. So the town or the corporation would enter into a draft letter of intent with one or more developers. And that draft letter of intent would basically say, we're going to work together with you for the next, say, 6 months as we work through numerous additional details to work on getting a more specific proposal and working on getting rid of all of the uncertainties and estimates around the environmental, all of the things that are still unknown to bring greater certainty. If all of that works out well, then there would be a purchase agreement between the developer and the corporation to purchase property and continue on developing. Or if it's not satisfactory to the developer, then there's the possibility to terminate the agreement. Why? Because we want to make sure that whoever comes to the party to develop Midland Bay Landing, we want a successful long-term relationship to get this built out successfully in accordance with the criteria that will be set out in the RFP. So next year is a huge year that we're going to make the biggest step of all as the corporation, and that is to find one or more developers to work with the corporation and the town to develop this property substantially in conformance with the master plan that you've seen. And if you remember, the master plan was the result of a year and a half of public consultations. And the public said a few really key things. It wanted access to the waterfront. It's got it, the large promenade. It wanted park space, 25%, 10 new acres of park and open space is part of the whole development. That is an essential ingredient of the master plan. And it's an essential part of what we, the corporation, are going to be making sure happens. So that part is really important. And we want to make sure that the other components, which is residential and commercial in a mixed use, all of that happens substantially in conformance with the framework that you have already seen in the master plan. So that's a very big step for 2022. Next slide. So in order to get to 22, we always need some money. So last year, council approved $275,000 of operating funds and some additional funding for capital. And the capital was substantially $250,000 for the interim use area, functional servicing review, which we didn't do, seawall engineering, and the engineering for the environmental did carry on. So for this year coming in 2022, we're not asking for any capital dollars, none. What we are asking for, you will see the honorariums, like I said before, remain the same. All of that remains the same. We are anticipating that we will need additional legal advice because we are going into a very serious and sophisticated process that will need additional legal advice, town support. So there's a small change, A, insurance, and B, legal advice to increase the operating costs. We're looking for, we reduced the executive director from $110,000 to $50,000 because of, like I said, most of us are contributing time towards that. And then we have consulting fees, principally for the real estate advisor we just talked about, potentially a fairness advisor, and some other engineering work to total $197,000. So in total, we're talking about $383,000. However, what we want to do is to use some operating reserve from our operating revenue from our reserve of $105,000 so that we come back to $278,000. Why is that important? Because that's the piece that affects the tax levy. It's exactly the same, more or less. So by doing it this way, there won't be any additional tax levy to continue to conduct and work with the Middle and Bay Landing Corporation for us to help the town bring this to reality. So we're asking for that amount of money. Now, at the same time, because of the way the municipal financing works and your budget process works, unfortunately, as much as we have $175,000 forecast left over from 2021, we can't use that technically, even though, so we need $130,000 for the first consultant being the real estate advisor. So we thought, well, okay, we can use some of that, but unfortunately, at the end of December, that money disappears. So tonight, we're going to be asking you for pre-approval for $130,000 for next year, because you won't have approved the town budget, which incorporates Middle Bay Landing. So we're going to ask tonight for council's pre-approval against the 2022 budget. So that will be coming later. So we believe that we've got lots of money that we could do it, but because of we're at the end of the year and you can't roll the money over. So we have to find a way to do that to keep up with the process that we lined up already for 2022. So that's the budget we're asking for in total. And tonight we're going to ask you to give us approval to award a contract and allow us to have pre-budget approval to do that. Next slide. We're all done. You've seen the pictures of the promenade, so this is a good spot to stop. And I am open for answering any questions that may come forward. There must be a question.
Question for Mr. Kernahan, Councilor Gordon.
Thank you for your presentation. A couple questions. One, when you talked about people having waived their compensation from this stipends, does that include the mayor and deputy mayor? Do they continue to waive their compensation? I think they did that in the past. I'm just wondering if they're continuing to do it. It's come up a couple times.
Yes, and the mayor and deputy mayor are not taking any compensation. And one of the directors is not taking any compensation.
Lovely, thank you. And a quick follow-up, the $105K that you state is gonna come from the Midland Bay Landing Reserve. My understanding is that's in a negative right now. There's several millions of dollars in debt in that reserve because that's where the loan is for buying Midland Bay Landing. Maybe just help me understand the finance side of this. How do we borrow money from an already severely, you know, negative reserve? Where's that cash actually come from?
So before Michael jumps in, as I said, we have, in fact, over the last 3 years, run at a considerable surplus for the last 3 years and generated a big surplus. The town could, if it elected, potentially move that surplus to the Midland Bay Landing Reserve to reduce that amount. In effect, it is a deficit. It is a deficit. So it could pay down the deficit from the operating dollars. That's a choice. So this deficit is intentional. The town paid for the property, and anything that gets capitalized against the property is added to, we'll call it, the mortgage. The full intention of this is that when the property is sold, the town will realize a return on that and pay off the debt that's going to be accumulated, just like any development. So you buy the land up front, you spend some money against it, and you expect to reap the rewards upon sale. And that's the same principle as we're working on here. I'm giving you the high level view, but maybe Michael could help with the technicalities.
Mr. Jeremy.
Hi, Councillor Gordon, and yes, Mr. Kernahan, I think he covered the majority of it, but yes, the Midland Bay Landing Reserve is in a deficit, as we would expect, as that was the source of funding for the initial acquisition of the land and any betterments that are occurring on that land. When we are looking at how these projects are funded and we're looking at pulling money from that reserve, I think the key thing to understand here is that when we have these surpluses that we've seen over the last number of years in the Midland Bay Landing operating budgets, we are recommending that those surpluses be transferred into that reserve as time goes on, and that we continue to use this reserve as essentially a way of flowing through the funds for projects that we would have going on the Midland Bay Landing. With respect to the surplus that Mr. Kernahan's talking about for 2021, yes, the issue is that at the end of 2021, those allocations, they expire. But we need to be in a position to award a contract. And at this stage, we don't have approval for 2022 yet. So we're kind of stuck in between. So what Mr. Kernahan is suggesting here is that we pre-approve the funds from the reserve, which will be used to fund this project, and that the surplus that we're generating in 2021 will also go to that reserve, essentially netting each other out. Actually, it would be well beyond netting itself out to the good there, because they're only asking for 130,000 against an anticipated 175 surplus. There was also a question about where is this money coming from? How do we have a deficit, and how is that still being paid for? essentially what you're seeing there is the deficit for the Midland Bay Landing Reserve is really being carried in the overall working capital of the town. We have many reserves, well north of 60 or 70 of them. Some are in surplus, some are in deficit. At the end of the day, they net out to a positive position in such that we are carrying an overall positive reserve balance. But yes, that's how it's being done, is through the overall working capital.
I would just like to interject here for a second and point out that we're all aware that real estate values in Midland have gone up significantly, particularly in the last 3 years. In Simcoe County, generally, they're up about 80% over a five-year period. What's happened here is that we've acquired an asset and we've improved the asset. So we've got a record of site condition on a brownfield that's approved by the MOE. We have a master plan. We have interim zoning. We certainly is embedded in the official plan. And each of these steps has added value to that property. That property is pledged as part of this reserve, so to speak. So as that property goes up in value, that's the piece that's paying back the operating costs of what Mr. Kernahan has described as a very efficient operation by the board. So in case anybody wonders where the funds are coming from, there's no question in my mind that they're coming from the enhanced value of the asset when it's actually, once we've selected, and this next step, as Mr. Kernahan has said, is the critical step in selecting a developer who will then financially participate in eliminating that debt and also contributing perhaps to sufficient funds that we may be able to apply them to other reserve or other requirements of the town. So it would seem, you know, I mean, Councillor Gordon looks at it as we're going deeper and deeper in the hole, and I guess that's the implication for what I think the question was. Reality is that the asset continues to go up and more than adequately covers any expenditures by this board now and going forward, or this in the board. Thank you. Any other questions for Mr. Kernahan? Mr. Kernahan, you want to say something?
No, I'm just open for more questions if there are any.
Councilor Gordon.
Thank you. I guess where I was getting is that I don't doubt that this asset is going to increase in value and already has. No, there's no arguing that. But the $105,000 that we're going to, you know, put in air quotes into this reserve so that it doesn't impact the levy, that's still $105,000 of Midland working capital money that's from our bank account this year or 2022, which means that's $105,000 we couldn't spend on playground apparatus or something else. If we want to spend $105,000 on playground apparatus and fund this negative reserve position, that's an extra 105K that would touch the levy. So we would be telling people, well, your taxes are going up because we're putting in more playground equipment, when in reality, we could have free playground equipment by not giving 105 to the negative reserve for Midland Bay Landing and use that free virtual money to buy the playground equipment. So I guess it's a bit of I understand, I'm not suggesting we're doing anything improper, but to say that, you know, your taxes aren't going up because of Midland Bay Landing, we're going to use this virtual $105,000. It's really in our Town of Midland bank account, but we're going to pencil it into this negative reserve. That's still 105K of Midland's money for 2022 that's going to be spent on something. And that means there's 105K less for us to use to help offset a tax increase that, you know, undoubtedly we're going to be delivering our residents, you know, in the coming months. So I guess that's my only point. It's still 105K. And like, this isn't fantasy money, right? It's coming out of our current bank account, hopefully going to be repaid one day when it sells.
Mr. Jeremy.
In this specific instance, the funds that the board is looking for are funds that have already been raised. Those taxes have been levied, they have been collected. Essentially, the issue is the money hasn't been spent. That's the essence of the surplus in this case. But what the board is looking to do is to access the funds that they have not spent in 2021 to be used in 2022. The reason we're having this conversation is on that technicality of their operating budget expiring at the end of 2021 in a situation where they do not yet have approval on their 2022 budget. So we're caught trying to, award a contract, but they need to make certain that they have crossed their T's and dotted their I's on ensuring that they have funds allocated for it. So what they are really trying to do is spend their 2021 allocation that has already been collected.
Thank you, Mr. Jeremy. Councillor Main, I see you had a question.
Thank you. Chair Kernahan. Thanks, Mr. McIntyre. I think Tina Fazio is on the call as well. Thank you to Mr. Douglas for your hard work on this. This is a very important topic. So thank you for all your time and effort on this. I guess really the best way to describe it, you're talking about this is a startup and we have a burn rate and it doesn't go positive until there's a sale or some agreement in the future. So I think that's probably a more apt analogy. So I just had a couple quick questions. So the biggest question for me is the brownfield. It sounds like we're getting to the point where our knowledge of it is very knowledgeable and we have a full extent of where there's pollution, where there's contamination. I guess also it says that what types of level of remediation. I think the huge good news story was that we probably will not have to remove contaminated waste off the site, which is great. But can we just talk about the brownfield for a second? Because a lot of people don't see it as a brownfield. A lot of people see it as kind of a young, mature forest with some lovely trees, a nice kind of passive green space. But it's not really a forest. It's certainly not a greenfield. It's very much a brownfield that has almost 40 plus years of bioremediation, I guess you could say. Can you guys talk about the finishing up of the brownfield record of site condition process? It sounds like that's nearly complete. And what are the implications for development? Thank you.
I think I will turn that over to Andy Campbell to fill in some details on that.
To Councillor Main, through the chair. Yes, we've spent a significant amount of money and time doing the environmental analysis on this site. And from one end to the other on this site, there is levels of contamination above what might be deemed clean fill, clean soil. So what the ministry has done is set what's called a certificate of property use, which outlines what the remediation needs to be on this site. Now they've sent that to us in draft. We just got it last week and we've got some negotiating to do with the ministry to make sure it matches the science that's been put forward. And we have until December 23rd to respond to the MECP on this. But a couple examples of what the Ministry of Environment is looking for is we've mentioned there'll be parkland on this site. One of the requirements will be that we'll have to put either a geomembrane and a half meter of soil or a full meter of clean soil wherever there is a park. For a tree, for example, normally you dig a tree pit and it's, about a cubic meter of soil has to be dug around each and every tree. The ministry is suggesting 32 cubic meters of soil, of clean soil, has to be put around every single tree. Buildings will need active or passive ventilation under the foundations of them on every building on the site. So those are the types of things that the ministry is saying that has to happen. But in general, the entire site is a brownfield and will need remediation of one measure or another by the time it's fully developed.
And just a quick follow-up on that, you're mentioning about the soil and that and trees and stuff. And a lot of people would love to retain as much trees as possible. I believe we even have a deputation at council, somebody who's going to be advocating for retention of as much green space as possible. We've talked, or at least I've mentioned, moving trees with tree spades. Now, with the brownfield contamination, that's probably not viable to be able to move some of the, eastern white pines or some of the trees. Or is that kind of getting into the weeds here of development?
Councillor Mann, I think that this isn't a woodlot. It's a scrub, a bunch of scrub in there that has, you know, as you mentioned, has grown for 30, 40 years. In general, you know, it's like any other development site. If you have to put, you know, roads in, sewers in, you've got to put a meter of clean fill in, as an example. The end result will be that site will be clear cut, except maybe along, Bayshore Drive and the slope up the hill. But, you know, that'll be dependent on what the developer proposes coming in, where they're putting buildings, where they're putting their roads. And we don't, have any of those explicit details at this time.
Bernahan, I saw your hand.
So if I could just perhaps paraphrase that, if you look at the site plan in the master plan, wherever there are buildings and roads, in effect, we're going to be capping whatever issues there are with contamination. As Mr. Campbell said, you cap it and you may need some ventilation from underneath. The areas where public access will be in parks, that is it. That is different use, and so it will need to be dealt with, as Mr. Campbell said. But if you look at the total site, as I mentioned before, there's about 10 acres of open space. Some of it will be paved, some of it will be open. So that area will need to be remediated, as he's mentioned. But as we build buildings on top of this, we're in effect capping whatever contamination is there. And as Mr. Campbell said, we're not going to be removing the soil from the site. We're going to manage it on site.
Thank you, Mr. Kearney.
Is that fair, Mr. Campbell?
That's a good summary.
I think it's important here to also realize, to Councilor Main's point, that a lot of this, we have a master plan which lays out apportionment, approximately. There's massing components to it. There's distribution and a whole bunch of factors in there. I think the purpose of today's conversation is not to get into, as Councilor Main said, the weeds or the trees, as the case may be, because we don't know what we're going to see from the proponents in terms of the act. There actually may be a slight different layout, but the proportions, the goal is that the proportions remain the same for the access to the water. I saw Councilor Prost's hand.
Thank you. So once the property's sold, okay, to start, I know we have to spend money to make money. Once the property is sold, would any of the benefits go back to our residents where there might be a zero tax increase?
Well, if we go to at a very high level, we've talked about the current deficit and it will increase. And when the property is sold, first of all, the debt from the reserve will be paid off. And then whatever surplus there is, then the town is free to use that surplus in whatever way it sees fit. It could create new programs. It could do other things, but I suspect not. Where the benefit comes from, when this development is done, you are now going to expand your tax base from 17,000 people to, let's say, 19,000 people. So you're going to have another couple of thousand people paying taxes every single year that's not revenue that you have now. That is a huge benefit of this development. It will help to pay for parks, it will pay for new programs, and that will help the tax base, because if you don't spread it wider, the only thing you can do is increase the taxes. So the long-term benefit is the new residents and businesses that are going to be at Midland Bay Landing will contribute to the town in perpetuity by paying their tax bill every year. That's the big benefit.
Thank you, Mr. Kernahan. But I do believe that one of the it's at the discretion of council, if there's a surplus with respect to the sale beyond the costs incurred, that we could, for example, hold the levy. It would be effectively, or other aspects, it would be up to council what they want to do, the council today. Mr. Jeremy, do you want to add to that?
Actually, I think between what Mr. Kernahan has explained around the growth of the property tax base and your worship, what you've said around the council of the day will make that decision. I think you've covered all the bases. That's really it.
And may your worship, Mr. Jeremy.
Your worship, may I make a comment?
Please.
Thank you. I just like to obviously echo some of those comments that were made. And I think it is an excellent question, Councillor Prost, on consequences of moving on with this asset. I think it is, if not the most important asset we have, certainly one of the most important assets we have. The development of the site, I think, first and foremost, I think will be just a tremendous, tremendous, you know, asset and benefit to the town. I think being able to control what that development looks like with the acquisition of this and some of the planning that's in place to make sure that the public realm is protected is extremely important. To have a contiguous harbor with our beautiful downtown that winds into those 40 acres, I think is unparalleled. And, you know, we saw that in the UNESCO Geopark analysis. This is a world-class asset we have. It is a world-class asset. So if you think people are attracted to Midland now, we're seeing, you know, appetite and growth for people to come to Midland. Think of what that appetite will be with, you know, a tremendous waterfront being developed with the public realm. I think that benefits everyone in this town. You know, growth is a very important aspect of our sustainability as a town, and you'll see that in the budget discussions that we'll certainly have. The specific benefits of, you know, 40 acres on a world-class harbor that has been improved thanks to the good work of a lot of good people that we just heard, I think are obvious. You know, I think you can retire that debt. I think you can enter an agreement that'll actually deliver you an annuity that helps the tax base, not just around the harbor, the entire town. So it's one of those benefits that I think that can help provide relief to the levy, and to Councillor Gordon's point, help pay for more playgrounds or whatever the town wants. We absolutely need to leverage these assets in a number of ways. So I really commend the work that's been done.
Thank you, Mr. Dunno. Did you have any follow-on, Councillor Prost, please?
Actually, I just have one more question. I might have missed it, but I'd like some clarity. If the soil still needs to be tested, it's already been moved around and things are happening. I'm just wondering how that happens before it's tested.
Mr. Campbell, please.
There's a provincial regulation on surplus soil, and that regulation requires testing before the final destination for the soil is where it's placed. And there's protocols around tracking all the truck movements. It's a very rigorous process. So we've tested the soil in situ. We moved some soil. We had to test it again before it will be placed in its final resting spot. And we're following the process. We've got those results back yesterday, and we'll be working to dispose of that soil as a what's called a Table 2 class of soil.
Does that mean it's not really good soil? It needs to be discarded?
No, we can get into a long discussion on this. There's 9 tables of classes of soil. Table 1 is what would be clean soil.
Okay.
I'll say there is no clean soil in Midland. There is no clean soil in most parts, in any built-up city in Ontario or likely North America. Table 1, I have not seen any soil in my 30 years test to clean standards. So right, So table 2 is what you look for, and table 2 is what can be put back on residential and parkland.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Councillor. I think Councillor Mann, you had another question, and then I see Councillor Gordon.
Thank you. A couple quick questions. Talking about some of the proposals that will be coming in this year, and then there's going to be a considerable due diligence and peer review, whatever. Is peer review of costing, if somebody gives a proposal saying, oh, I can build a building for 10, are we going to get those numbers peer reviewed and somebody's going to say, well, they can't build buildings for 10, they cost 10 to 15? are we going to get to that level of detail of peer review with some of the proposals coming in? Second question, executive director 2022. It sounds like we're going with the executive director light model, which is great for the volunteers, but I mean, the whole notion was to have an executive director to have kind of as the point person, to have that skill set. And finally, urban design guidelines. That's something that we're all excited to see. I'm guessing that won't come until later. Thank you.
So if I can answer your three questions in reverse order. Urban design guidelines, they will be part of it. It was contemplated way back with the master plan and subsequently during the official plan that the urban design guidelines would be part of it, but in all likelihood would be best developed along with the developer. So it would be joint between the developer and the town to come on agreement on mutually acceptable urban design guidelines. So I'm working in reverse order. So next year, I did say that we have a big year on what we're going to be doing. The three working group folks are continuing to do that and will continue to do that over the next year. There are many, many hours, far in excess of 110,000 of an executive director. So we are doing that at no cost to the town. We will continue to do so. And last is when proposals come in from a developer, the developer is going to be taking the risk. So if the developer thinks that they can build something for X dollars or Y dollars, that's their risk. That's not the town's or the corporation's risk. So this is, we're not building a building here at the town's risk. This is all about risk allocation. So the risk is being transferred to the developer that come to us with a financial proposal and you are going to build this area or area of the site, and we'll use the example. We're going to come to you with a proposal and we're going to submit a proposal to develop the east half of the site, whatever the east half, call it that. And there's low-rise residential, there's additional promenade, and there's a park that's shown in the master plan. So they might come and say, we will give you X dollars for that, but we don't want to enter into an agreement that says, well, we'll give you X dollars and they do nothing. We will want to set some milestones of performance so they don't tie up the land and disappear. We've seen that before. We want performance, so they will need to perform at a timetable to develop the property, but the risk is with them. So during the due diligence period that I referred to, that's the time to shake out all of these details so that both parties are going ahead knowledgeably that the proposal works.
Thank you, Mr. Kernahan.
So we won't have a peer review to answer your question directly.
Thank you.
So we'll see conventional tools then of letters of credit for public realm and that types of thing, what we're used to seeing for types of development in town, or is that?
You may not.
Okay.
You may see as part of the development agreement that the developer is to create and pay for this amount and this design. So that kind of thing. So it may not be a letter of credit. It may be bound into the overall payment scheme. Those are details to work out, but it won't be the conventional fashion.
Thank you, Mr. Kernahan. Mr. Campbell, did you have something you wanted to add there?
Yeah, I'd just like to say, once the zoning is set, this site will still go through the standard plan of subdivision, site plan, and all of the normal practices there. So if you know, securities, checking of engineering, checking of drawings, that whole process will still be as per the Planning Act and our standard rules.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell.
Yes, I agree.
So I have Councillor Gordon and then Councillor Olszewski.
Thank you. This is great to have this opportunity to ask these questions and get all this sort of focus. We can't normally do this at regular council meetings about Middle Bay Landing. So I know in the past week and a bit, I've had a lot, like almost a litany, I'd call it, of emails back and forth with the CAO about the purpose of the land clearing. I did watch the last Development Corporation meeting and was, I still remain perplexed how you guys didn't know that the town was going to undertake this, that we never told you. So I apologize for that you didn't weren't made aware of that. But I was shocked too about the land clearing because it came out of nowhere and I thought it was you guys that did it. And we had I think Mr. Kernahan, you and I had a quick email exchange where you told me that no, it wasn't nothing to do with you guys, it was the town. So I still to this day have yet to get I'll just call it a straight answer of exactly why we've cleared that land. Are we building a parking lot? Are we putting in foundations? What are we doing? All I know is that we're making it safe and making it ready. And sort of those vague generalities I'm really looking for. This is the perfect venue. Let's be precise. Exactly why did we bulldoze that land and what is going on it?
So I'd just like to comment.
One of three questions I have there. So
I'm just going to comment on that very quickly and I'm going to turn it over to Mr. Deneau.
Thank you.
First and foremost is that during budget process, particularly with respect to the budget for the demonstration site, it was identified that the town would be doing work on that site. And perhaps we'd like to combine the two efforts. It was deemed that opportunity was not acted upon, and the town continued then to do work on the actual park itself and had plans to actually beef the place up and an incorporated part of this into the a demonstration site for the cruise ships coming in. And I believe I've seen the correspondence from Mr. Deneau, and he explained that this site was being cleared for safety of the operators of not only the town and the Canadian Border Security Agency, but also for the people who are operating the cruise ships. And that correspondence, I've been monitoring that back and forth. So I see no reason to apologize to the board. The board chair was certainly aware that this was going on, as were, I believe, other members of the board. That Mr. Douglas wasn't, I can't speak to that. But, Mr. Deneau, would you like to answer that?
Yeah, thank you, Your Worship. But apparently my video is not working, but I'm hoping you can hear the audio.
Yes.
Regardless. But yes, I don't, again, and Councillor Gordon and I have had discussions about this specific issue and other issues that are similar. And there's this, there's the suspicious nature of some of these queries that tend to be, I think, unhelpful when you're trying to do work of this nature. Working with any site and dealing with material of this matter is nothing new for the professionals that we have in this town. We developed, King Street, where there was contaminated soil. We've developed other areas where there's contaminated soil. So handling that soil is nothing new for these professionals. And they do this all the time. So to suggest that something nefarious was going on with that is just, I think it's a careless comment and doesn't strike the trust that I think is these people have earned through the work that they've done. And that's certainly true for, the question that was answered to Councillor Prost on what was done with that material. The site was cleaned up, and whether you think it's a vague response or not, it was cleaned up because it needed to be safer. We are preparing it for what could happen down the road. We're trying to make it a better site for people to use and a safer site. When we did the walkway, it exposed some areas that were not safe. We had to cut bolts. We had to take care of it. We had to fence that off. And because of the nature of the weather that was available, our crew took the opportunity to do some clearing. That's the answer. And I've told you that answer. However, you seem to suggest it's, we're being evasive. That is the answer. And we've dealt with the material as the professionals normally do. So to suggest that something isn't happening, I think, is really burying the lead, as they say, on this property. A tremendous amount of work has gone on, as Mr. Kernahan has said, to make this property better for our residents. I've been down there talking to the people fishing at that spot, and they remark at how many more people are enjoying that property now. And the work that's being gone. And they were thankful for that. Now, there may be people that are concerned, but I don't think we should feed anyone who's suspicious of the activity being done by professionals who continue to take care of this town every day. I guess if there is some frustration that I express, it's because of it.
Thank you, Mr. Deneau.
Okay, fair enough. So I still don't know what we're doing with it. Like, do we bulldoze it so we just let grass grow on it again? Or are we going to do something? Is there a reason why we flattened it out? All I want to know is why do we choose that plot of land to, you know, to bulldoze or whatever we did with it to flatten it out? Are we just going to let it go back to grass, or are we doing something with it? I just want to know what we're doing with it. What's the plan? Nothing nefarious.
They're prepping the site so it's safe to operate. I think that's what Mr. Deneau has said. I've heard that. I read that in the correspondence. What that ultimately looks like, I'm afraid the weather is caught up with it, as Mr. Deneau and I believe Mr. Campbell also pointed out. What happens with it, I think, will depend on feedback from the cruise ship people as to what they want to see there in the interim, because I'm not sure that that's the final site. In fact, I'm sure it's not the final site for cruise ships. And I think that it's important that staff be allowed to utilize their expertise and not worry about looking over their shoulders, because every time they do something, somebody wants to know whether they're planting grass or laying asphalt or doing whatever. You can pick up the phone, you can talk to people. They've given you an answer that you're not satisfied with. I understand that, but frankly, yeah, there you have it.
Okay, so I'm not going to beat a dead horse. I got two other questions that are related, but nothing to do with the clearing of the land.
I'll give you benefit of those questions after Councillor Prost.
Thank you.
Sorry, and then I have Councillor. I have Councillor Shefsky as well.
Sorry, I don't mean to interrupt. I have another commitment, and I really have to go. Mm-hmm. I'll be back for the meeting at 6, and again at 7. I just wanted to let you know that.
Thank you, Councillor.
I don't like leaving before the end of the meeting, but I really don't have a choice today.
I understand. Thank you. Okay. Thank you for the courtesy.
Thanks.
Councillor Shefsky, and then we'll go back to Councillor.
Your Worship, I wanted to voice my appreciation and support. I really appreciate the working group, Executive Director Light, as it was called. I'm a huge fan of that model. I like that. And the board members as well, but the ones that have not taken pay is certainly recognized in my eyes. I'll support moving the budget money to next year, because I believe that money is gained as a fruit of your labor. I think you did it for the betterment of this property and the betterment of this development, and not to build a playground. So I certainly support moving that money in the next year. And I understand it's budgetary technical stuff that mumbo jumbo it's over my head. So I certainly support you bringing that money in the next year. As Mr. Deneau said, I think this is the highest potential property for Midland in the future. I think this is our ticket out of the highest taxed municipality in Simcoe County. I will sleep better the day that people stop saying that out loud. So I'm behind you 150%. I think the airport's a close second, but this is number one in my eyes, and I support you guys. I support what you guys are doing. I really appreciate the board members and the working group. Executive Director Light, I'll wear the t-shirt all day long. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Councillor. Councillor Gordon, I wore on the agenda, so if we can sort of keep it to, we'll try and keep it to a little more.
Yeah, no problem. And I don't even think I'm trying to be confrontational here. These are just questions that I've had pent up that I wanted to ask here. So with cruise ship docking enhancements, because clearly they're going to be longer than our promenade, and there's some obstructions as you start to look, west along the shoreline. What enhancements do we have planned? How are we funding those? And are they happening in 2022? Because my concern is if we don't have, especially with the plague not going to end anytime soon with Omicron and whatever the next one is, if we don't have confirmed cruise ships arriving in 2022, and this is going to be an ugly budget, like we keep hearing about this, why wouldn't we push off any spend and enhancements till 2023, when we know what the world looks more like and whether we're really going to welcome, multi-hundred foot cruise ships into town?
I think that's probably a conversation for the 2022 budget, which is coming up next month, and we'll hear about it, about the budget itself later in the regular council meeting. Mr. Campbell, if you want to say add to that, please.
Yeah, if I may, council approved $50,000 for us to do some work for the cruise ship improvements. And that budget was approved last year. We haven't spent all that money yet. We're looking to care, because it's in the capital budget, that automatically rolls forward. So we don't have the issue like Mr. Kernahan is having with his project. And we're not asking for new funds, but down there we'll have to get rid of all the trip hazards on that concrete section beside the seawall. So, and do some, some topsoiling, do some seeding and things like that. So we're not asking for new money in 2022 to finish that work because council's already approved money for us.
Thank you, Mr. Campbell. You had another question, Councillor Gordon?
No, I'm done. We'll do it another time. I don't want to steal the mic as I usually try to. Sorry about that. Go ahead.
Thank you. Deputy Mayor Ross.
Thank you very much, Your Worship. I just wanted to echo Councillor Chesky's comments. I sit on the board, and for the record, I've never taken a penny, any type of stipend. And I know, Your Worship, you have not either. But with that said, I do want to thank everyone involved, the board of directors. I sit on the board. I'm a wine salesman and a deputy mayor, and I cannot tell you the things that I've learned and just understand how the whole process. This is well beyond, honestly, any of us sitting here as a member of council. This is a huge development. We look at the huge opportunities for our community. And I envision, if we can get this thing up and running in my lifetime, we're probably looking at $7-8 million revenue per year for this town of Midland that is desperately needed. We hear every day that our taxes are too high. What can we do? This is what we can do. This is it. This is the opportunity of a lifetime that we'll never, we'll never get this opportunity again. So I really have to thank the board. I wish I knew more knowledge, and as a rep, I do my best I can to investigate and research and come prepared, but it totally is beyond any scope that I could ever imagine. And I can't thank Mr. Kernahan and the rest of the board for all the hard work and what a deal we've got. Look where we are, and with the Nandesco and the rest of it moving forward, this is opportunity. The future of Midland sits right here, right in front of us. So thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Deputy Mayor. And I think I can speak on behalf of council in our appreciation for the efforts of the board and staff in supporting the board and the triumvirate, if you like, that's doing the general manager's work, or as they've said, general manager light. I see Mr. Deneau has his hand up. Mr. Deneau.
Thank you, Your Worship. I just want to make sure I thank a few people as well, because I do think this has been, I've been here for 20 months, and certainly this has been just an amazing year for this particular project. Through a pandemic to create the kind of spaces that our public can continue to enjoy, to do the geopark analysis that was done that shows this is a world-class asset, to work on the zoning, to get the environmental work to a stage where, we've got some good clarity on that, to deliver, significant budget savings is really because you're working with such fine professionals on this board and the people that support them. And try and find this caliber of people for the amount of money that we're compensating them, it can't be done. It just can't be done. This is an extremely effective, valuable, and when I say value in terms of cost, that we are deriving from the board and the staff members who support them. So I really want to thank the entire board. It's been a real pleasure to work with them. They are true professionals, and I can tell you that they have the true interest of Midland. They are residents around Georgian Bay, and they know the value of this place, and they want to keep it as beautiful as it is and make sure it continues to be enjoyed. So thank you to all of them. That working group has been tremendous to work with. I want to thank a few of our staff, though, because they tend to be behind the scenes, and they've done some tremendous work. So certainly Angela, and Bill and I talked about this. Angela, who supports this committee, tremendous, to getting us together and coordinating that. I want to thank Angela. I want to thank our finance team. Obviously, there's, some important things we had to take care of. They did that while we were managing, new auditors and trying to deliver a budget ahead of schedule, both of which they did. So thank you to them. Engineering and planning, you've heard from them today. So thank you to Andy and Mitch and the team who are handling that. Adam and his team who are working on the planning side, tremendous amount of work in planning, but, again, this is a priority for us to make sure this gets done. And I also want to thank Kim and procurement. You know, procurement in the public sector, you know, has to be transparent. There are very, you know, important rules we have to respect to make sure it's being done competitively and transparently. And Kim makes sure that's all done. And she's been extremely responsive in supporting us in doing that. So I want to thank all of them in particular. But I think it's just been a tremendous, tremendous year of accomplishments by this entire group. So I want to commend all of those members and thank them.
Thank you, Mr. Deneau. I think at this point, I'm going to read a motion into the record and ask council to vote. So moved by Deputy Mayor Ross, seconded by Councillor Gordon, that the Midland Bay Landing Development Corporation and a report to the shareholder dated December 8th, 2021 be received for information and the council approved the budget for the contract for the real estate advisory consulting services and Barry Lyon Consultants Limited in the amount of $129,950 inclusive of HST to be funded from the Midland Bay Landing Services Fund. Council, you've heard the question. All those in favor. Deputy Mayor Ross.
Just for clarity, Your Worship, we're only approving the 129. We're not approving the whole budget. The rest of that conversation will happen at our budget. I just wanted to make sure that was transparent and the public were aware of that.
Well, unless Mr. Kernahan wants to take a haircut, that's correct. I don't think he does. So, yes, it's just the amount for the consultant.
Correct.
All in favor? Thank you. Against? Thank you. That carries. Next, we have the audit financial statements. I'm not sure who's presenting that. So is that Mr. Jeremy or is that to you, Mr. Kernahan?
No, I think it would be Mr. Jeremy.
Jeremy. Thank you. Mr. Jeremy, over to you.
All right, good evening. So yes, we have the audited financial statements for Midland Bay Landing Development Corp for the year ended December 31st, 2020. I'm happy to report that we have a clean auditor's opinion again this year, which means that they did not find any material misstatements that would cause them to issue a qualified opinion. The financial statements themselves, there's not a tremendous amount of activity to be seen here, but something that is worth noting is that we have recognized into revenue this year the $50,000 in the deferred contributions from the County of Simcoe for some of the work that was done around the geopark. So that's, I would say, the big item that we're looking at. Outside of that, it's the same, essentially the same disclosures that we've had in the past, where we talk about the Midland Bay Landing, the idea, of course, being, as we've discussed through this meeting, that we would see the initial investment that the town has made through the acquisition of the property, eventually recouped and then some through the ultimate disposition of the property.
Thank you, Mr. Jeremy. Questions for Mr. Jeremy around the audit statements? Seeing none. I'm sure that's no reflection on the statements themselves or Mr. Jeremy's presentation. Thank you, Mr. Jeremy. I'll read into the record then a motion moved by Councillor Main, seconded by Councillor Downer, that the approved Midland Bay Landing Development Corporation audit financial statements for the year ending December 1st, 2020, be received as information, and that BDO Canada LLP be confirmed as the external auditor for the Midland Bay Landing Development Corporation for the calendar years 2021-2022 with the option for 2 1-year extensions. So council, you've heard the motion. Any comments or questions with respect to the motion itself? Seeing none, then all of those in favor. Thank you, and that too carries. Next on the agenda, we have current confirmation of the Board of Directors. Moved by Councillor Downer, seconded by Councillor Main, that the Board of Directors for the Midland Bay Landing Development Corporation be confirmed as follows. Mr. Bill Kernahan, Director and Chair. Mr. John McIntyre, Director and Vice Chair. Mr. Robert Barber, Director. Mr. Zach Douglas, Director. Ms. Tina Fazio, Director. Mayor Stuart Strathern, Director. And Deputy Mayor Mike Ross, Director. The last two are two directors are by dint of the office that they hold, and it's within the charter of the corporation. So I think I'm just going to call the question. Any comments or questions around the motion? Okay, seeing none, then all those in favor. Thank you. Finally, we have the confirmatory bylaw, which is moved by Councillor Gordon, seconded by Councillor Olszewski. A bylaw 2021-52 being a bylaw to adopt the proceedings of the special meeting of council with the Bay Landing Development Corporation annual general meeting held on December 8th, 2021, be passed and enacted. Are there any comments or questions to ask nonetheless? Seeing none, then all in favor. Thank you. That carries. And then usually the motion of the meeting, moved by Deputy Mayor Ross, seconded by Councillor Main. The special meeting of council, Middle Bay Landing Development Corporation annual general meeting adjourned at 5:10 p.m. All those in favor? Thank you. That carries. And once again, thank you to the board for their continued efforts. And I'm looking forward. This is going to be sort of an inflection year by the looks of it. I wish everybody well in getting to the results that we hope will turn Middle Bay Landing into a real demonstration site for how to develop waterfronts. So again, thanks to the board and good night. We'll see you at 6 o'clock, council, for